Awesome. Hello, everyone. Welcome to tomorrow's Headless Drupal today. And I would just like, every time we do that, we have to do it all together. So can I just ask for 100% participation, and I'll hold the room hostage until I get it, that we all pump our fists in the air and say the word today together with some gusto and enthusiasm. So let's try it. We're talking about tomorrow's Headless Drupal today. Man, I wish I had my webcam recording. This is me. My name is Matt. My business is called Rather Creative. I have a practice that is at the intersection of custom Drupal development modules and themes and what gets called front-end engineering these days. JavaScript apps and you know display and behavior related things. I solve interesting problems. If you have an interesting problem, I would love to talk with you about it. I mean a technology-related problem, not a like persistent itch or something like that. I mean, if you have like relationship problems, I would probably enjoy hearing about them, but I'll mostly laugh and not help you very much. Technology-related problems, however, is good. And if you are a developer and you're looking for booking, maybe let's talk too. You are an experienced Drupal site builder and can create content types, add fields, create views, configure modules, and stuff like that. That's what I'm assuming, and that's what the technical. We won't get anywhere if we have to fill in the kind of technical scaffolding around everything that I'm going to say. So that's my assumption based on level of knowledge. I'm also assuming that you are not. Going to give me too hard a time, because if you are super dev, some of the things I'm going to say, there will be problems with them that will be apparent to you, and we can talk about them a little bit in the questions. But I think what I'm going to say represents reasonable compromises under real world agency conditions. So headless Drupal, I try, you know. I really put a lot of work and effort into these to make them exciting for everybody. What this means, and there have been half a dozen sessions about it so far, but it means disaggregating the display. Drupal's big advantage, have you ever had a client ask you, why use Drupal and not WordPress? My stock answer for that, which you're welcome to steal if you like, is that Drupal has better content modeling tools, and you get for free an interface to set them up, right? At what we call node types. That is actually very hard in other systems, especially if you want to enforce validation on certain, you know, on certain of the inputs on the forums that you create. It's amazing that we get that for free, that you can type a pattern into a text box and, you know, Drupal will reject that based on you know, the pattern that you typed into a text box that's stored in the database or in features, because, you know, we all use good Drupal hygiene. So that's the thing. And then, by the way, for free, you get an administrative interface. And if you saw Rain's session yesterday about cleaning up the admin UI for content editors, you realize that we can do amazing things just with vanilla Drupal in terms of modeling, in terms of the information architecture, modeling content types, and getting people really pretty darn good interfaces to use them. But there's been this talk, I guess, on the headless GDO group about whether headless is the right term. Josh referred to it yesterday. Steve talked about it. Maybe Matt talked about it in his talk. I think of a website's head being its brain, being the business logic and the database and things like this, knowledge, and procedures. The display layer is more like the website's clothes. So I'm going to propose naked Drupal as the thing. If you are looking to leverage the, excuse me, I'm just going to go off on a rant here. Can we cool it with the leverage? Can we not leverage anything anymore? I'm not talking about the physics principle of mechanical advantage. I'm not talking about borrowing money to buy stocks and amplify your financial gain using, you know, things. When you say leverage, you mean use. We are not going to leverage jQuery. We're going to use jQuery, right? We're not going to leverage Drupal. We're going to use it, right? We're not going to leverage the rich client-facing experience and open the kimono and drill down with a net gain in all of our KPIs. We're going to build a website. Okay, rant over, back to our show, Naked Drupal. Right, so the idea is to outsource the display layer to a different system. This gets talked about under the rubric of the programming principle of separation of concerns. Sometimes it gets talked about as being a services architecture. A service style architecture where your company's technology stack has a lot of small pieces loosely joined, to use the Unix term in a context for which it was never intended, so that there is a displayer, right? There is a data holder. There are various kinds of small components that do one thing well. Yesterday in Matt's talk, he talked about Gopher. I actually would like to see a Gopher front end because I, when I had a shell account, like in the early 90s, I would Gopher. Anyone go to the internet wiretap? You remember that one? A lot of conspiracy theory. Gopher documents. Yeah, you know what I'm talking about. So there's talk about the, get your fist pump ready. There's talk about Drupal 8 being having a REST server built in first class. That's great, but we don't have to wait for Drupal 8. We can have tomorrow's headless Drupal today. the title of the talk is a Phineas and Ferb reference to the flying car of the future today. So this slide is in honor of John Romine, who pointed it out to me and said he was going to come for that reason. John, you can leave now. You've seen your slide. this talk is going to focus on the Drupal side. I'm going to talk about front-end implementation because it's what I do all day, a little bit, and maybe drop some knowledge. But I'm assuming you know something about the kind of front-end app that you want to build and how to build it, though I'm going to drop a few truth bombs on you at the end. But the first thing to remember, that as good as this is not magic. Even with Drupal 8, you can't just add .json to your endpoints and get a beautiful API, right? I want, APIs need love and care the same way that the front end of a website, the same way that HTML pages need love and care. Let's not be lazy. Let's build beautiful, useful APIs that are well thought out. And in some sense, this is the real web design, right? Because you're designing the way that the web talks to itself when you're doing API design. Another thing I want to point out is that when you're talking about disaggregating the front end, decoupling the front end from the business logic and the data store of your website, you're not just talking about JavaScript apps. Angular is the hotness, and it's great. I've built in Backbone. I haven't built anything, any client work in Angular yet, but seeing Steve's talk yesterday made me want to. But it doesn't mean that it's right for every application. The disaggregated front-end display could be a mobile app. It could be a Ruby on Rails site, right, that consumes data from Drupal as a data store, and you're just building the thing. Or the what's the Symphony Lite one? Silex? Right. Yeah. It could be Silex to get you get what you need. You get routing, and you can put some views on and get the data from Drupal. Right. So JavaScript is the hotness right now, but it's not for every application. And even though everyone is talking about headless at this camp, literally every session is about headless. Even the ones that aren't are, in some sense, that we can do. This is not a substitute for building websites in the Drupal theming layer, right? It's not. This is not like the way we do Drupal now. This is a way to do Drupal that has gotten easier over the years, that has some advantages and some cons that might fit the needs of your project. Just off the top of my head, brainstorming a couple things, you could do a headless Drupal implementation of an auto-updating latest comments sidebar block. right? Where it goes. And I'm not saying that's an interesting implementation, but inside your Drupal block that you put on the page with context module, or even the blocks interface, right? You could write JavaScript, a Drupal behavior, and we all use Drupal behaviors to put our JavaScript on the page, right? Yes, excellent. Nice, I'm glad to hear that. You could have JavaScript that queries your own website at a JSON endpoint that you set up, gets the latest comments, and dumps them into the block. I also want to point out the irony of Drupal 8, because I'm very excited about the theming layer in Drupal 8. It's actually pretty cool, right? And all the Twig stuff, I've been building in Twig recently, and it's really great. Now that the theming system has become more theoretically pure and has become a little closer to what the front-end professionals have been asking for all along, now we're just kicking the theming system out and doing these headless implementations. There are some downsides to doing this sort of architecture, and I think it's worth it to be honest about what they are. Actually, a lot of the talks have talked about these. You lose the tight integration of the display layer and the front end, right? Because even though the Drupal theme is theoretically supposed to be distinct from the business logic that's in the modules, it does get to be even if you're very tidy about it does get to be a bit of a soup sometimes, and even just that edit link when you're logged in, right, on the node, the ability to hit a button at the bottom of your node form and preview that node and get the preview and the node form together, you lose that, or rather you have to recreate it, so you don't get it for free anymore if you're doing a custom module. Here's another one. You have to define the data model twice. Right, once in the back end of your website in what's going to be persisted to the database, and again in the front end thing. Right, it's little known fact, the M in MVC stands for node types, and you have to tell your application what your node types are so that you can get them from the back end. And though that's not too big a deal, and actually may even be good sometimes, because I was in the Pimple talk. And I heard a distinction yesterday. I'd heard a distinction that I'd never heard before between a domain model and a persistence model. You actually need to model different things for display than you necessarily want in the persistence layer of the website. So you actually can enforce hygiene in that by separating those things out. Still, there is, and I realize this is hand waving because I'm proposing a problem that I have not yet had, but there is, guys, there is the potential for these two models to drift out of sync, right? And you don't necessarily, and that would be bad if it happens. What if, right, what if some well-meaning site builder on the back end changes what gets output by one of your JSON endpoints, or changes the content type definition of a particular content type so that you're getting different JSON than your front-end app is expecting. You got to stay on top of that stuff. Great. So I'm going to focus on printing out content and not on editing or interactivity. Right, I'm going to completely punt on the question of Drupal get form or the web form module and kind of re-implementing those things on the front end. And I'm kind of going to punt on authentication. This is for a couple of reasons. If you're most of them terrible, but one I think okay, which is that if you're committed to the Drupal admin, you're going to go into slash admin anyway to edit your content. And also, there are some things up in the air in terms of authentication and stuff like that. And also, because what I'm going to propose to you is sort of a hack, right? You can't use all the HTTP verbs in Drupal 7 REST because it doesn't deal with requests in precisely the sophisticated way that 8 is going to deal with requests. So, there are my disclaimers. All that said, let's set up headless.dev. So this is inside a vanilla Drupal 7 install, which is what I'm using. We're going to put in views data source, the services module, Devel so that we can get Devel generate libraries because it's a dependency, and REST-WS. So I'm going to talk about Vue's data source services and the RESTful web server, REST-WS, and then we're going to enable those modules on a version Drupal install. Create a content type called data. Default settings are fine. Default image and tag fields that come in Drupal 7. And we're going to add extra fields, an integer, and a list. By the way, when you add list fields, the key value is what a lot of these headless things are going to return, right? Not the pretty label value. So if you have like values 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 and pretty labels option 1, option 2, option 3, option 4, option 5, you're going to get 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 in the JSON. So we have this. Right? And don't forget to spend some time here and really address these settings. Just to echo what Rain said, content editors are users too. Though Drupal gives us all of the tools, a lot of the work you do as a developer is paring down the tools to the ones that are relevant to your problem domain. Great, so we're going to use the magic of Devel generate to generate taxonomy terms. Devel generate has a sense of humor because these are the taxonomy terms that it gives us. We're going to use Devel generate to create some node types. And this is the result of that. So we have some nodes, so we have data for free. There it is. The ultimate result is an ugly site. But we actually want it to be uglier. Right? We want it to be a wall of text. So we want machine parsable structured data. And the idea of this talk is how not to wait for Drupal 8, how to get this out of 6 and 7. Okay, so let's stop and think, right? A lot of the separation between a big hurdle that I went through in my career making websites is the ability not to develop, but to stop developing and think. What is the problem we're trying to solve? Are we trying to solve the right problem at the right level of abstraction at the right time? So what is our goal here? We want a list of things, right? We want a list of nodes as JSON. We have a tool in Drupal for making lists of things. It's views. So let's go over to views and see what we get, right? Views is not a bad tool for API design. It's already in every Drupal developer's bones, so you don't have to learn anything new. It has an easy interface for grouping related information together. That is to say, if you have a lot of views that are the same but a little different, just cloning displays, you could do worse than cloning for cloning displays. You can put different routes on the displays. You can use query parameters to filter information. You can use what gets called contextual filters or URL arguments to filter information. You get all of this for free. I guess that is some leverage. We are leveraging views. Okay, so create a view of data nodes. Awesome. Hey, nice. What's this? Include an RSS feed. My goodness, this is going to be a short talk. We're done, right? Right. Without anything special other than other than views, we can output all these Drupal nodes in a structured format. What? What's the catch? It's the WordPress problem. I'm sorry, I couldn't resist getting one dig in Drupal camp. WordPress has a content modeler, starts out of the box with a content model that has a headline and a body. Right? And we don't like big blobby body fields. We like chunked out content because we have heard all the content strategy talks and we know about the work of these people and we want to separate all these things into different fields so that they can be mix and matched on our front end. Right? This is what makes this is what makes Drupal useful. What makes RSS useful is that there is a pretty basic specification and it looks, you know, the output looks like this. In that item, element, a title, a link, and a description, a pub date, an empty Dublin core element there, and then a GUID, which, you know, is not super useful to us. So it encodes the HTML entities in the body field and sticks that in the description. None of those other fields that we have and stuff like that. Okay, so we have custom display settings. We can create an RSS display on the content type. And we want, we want them to go in, and we want all these things in so we can put them on the RSS display. That fixes it, right? No, it doesn't fix it. It serializes everything as HTML and encodes it and drops it into that description field. Okay. Maybe in our RSS display, we use instead of the content row plugin, we use the fields row plugin and do that. Nope, can't do that because we're limited by the RSS spec. There's only one description field. But guys, XML is more than just our RSS. We can do this. I know we can do this. So there is a module called Views Data Source to the rescue, and we're gonna. And Matt talked about it yesterday. Yeah, and we're gonna create. We're going to install it, enable the Views JSON module, and create an XML document display, which is a different display type than page node, page block feed, things like this. This is what the style options are. Let's talk about these. We want raw XML as the schema that we can get OPML or Atom. I don't know why you would use Atom, but there it is. I had just left these with the default values. Matt's suggestion yesterday that you take out the Matt Chapman's suggestion yesterday that you take out the root element name and the top level child element name so that you just get your items is actually much better than what I have here. Normal field output, nested element output so that it's not all so that it's not all flat. And what do we get? Oh, thank goodness. This is what we want. And you're going to have to massage each field, right? You'll notice that the markup is gone from the body field here so that you can go into the field display settings and fix that. You get this is really nice. The image is not a StreamWrapper URI. The image is a URL that you can access. You want to, the tags aren't linked to anything, so you can mess around with that. Oh, this is XML. Sorry, this is the Views XML plugin, not the Views JSON plugin. Who was confused? Sorry. And you can change the XML element names by, right now they're the defaults, field image, field tags, field integer, and field list, title and body. You can change those names by changing the label setting in the row. Sorry, in the field display settings. Make sure, don't do the thing that I did and do it globally for the whole view because then it does everything. Make sure you're only doing it for this particular display. And we can clone this view, make it a JSON display, and get JSON. Same principles apply, right? These are the options. You actually can get rid of those root object and top level child object names, which I learned today. Awesome. Field output, normal, yes. Don't do raw. Raw gives you what's in the database, and you actually want it processed from what's in the database. Mr. Rifkin.
Have you used the JSONP prefix before with this?
No, I haven't.
Has anybody in the room used that?
But oh, I tested it. I actually have this running on my local, and maybe in a second we can put it on. It wraps the object in a
Yeah.
function name. Yeah.
It gets around some security issues, so I'm wondering, because that's, a lot of cores arguments or
Yeah.
JSONP.
You can get around cross origin problems. So yeah, it's cool. So this so we're all good, right? No, we are not all good. This is what comes out. It would not be a Drupal talk without an obscure setting. And the obscure checkbox that you have to check is Views API mode must be turned off. Otherwise, Views is going to pass the output into the Drupal theming engine and it's going to wrap it in the various wrappers up to HTML. I totally missed this the first time I tried this. I had to ask my friend Google about it. So that's okay. So what we get is let's see if I can pull it up. I think I have MAMP running. There it is. It ain't pretty, but it works, right? And you can see actually up. It's gonna be fun. Up here, if we got rid of the. we got rid of these global elements, it would actually be a lot more useful to us. So then this is the this is what comes out, and you can see in here. Actually, let's JS beautify this. Oh, there's a lot of data in there. Even my MacBook is choking on this. All right, let's not JS beautify this because it's going to take forever just to paste. But you can see that down in the image field, you get a good URL to the image. In the tags, you actually get outputted. You get output HTML, so you probably want to massage that. But you know, with very little effort, we have JSON for all of this. And by the way, the XML one, I put at XML. Great. Oh, it's thinking. Yep, that's actually. I'm gonna look and I have a plugin that's supposed to pretty print JavaScript and JSON. Maybe it needs .json or the right content type or something like that. So, hey, huge success. Let's go back and continue on. So, continue on. The next way that we can do this is the services module. Though honestly, if you want to stop there, that's probably okay. Right? And you get a lot in views. You get the ability to, with relationships, to relate other kinds of data to, so that you can build up pretty, pretty sophisticated objects. You get all the stuff I was talking about in terms of being able to make displays. You don't get authentication, but I'm punting on that anyway today, so there you go. But there are other options, and I want to tell you what they are. The services module at admin structure services. You enable the services module and the service that you're going to use. There is an XML RPC one that comes with it, but don't do that. What you really want is the REST server. To configure it, you add an endpoint, right? Which represents a place that we're going to go to get information out of our Drupal site. A unique combination of a path along with a server and whether it's authenticated or not. And then resources or data that you're going to pull out are specific to the endpoint. So you could have, for example, an authenticated and an unauthenticated endpoint with different resources available for each. But without authentication, all the requests are done with the permissions level of an anonymous user in the services module. So you set up a service. You know, here it is. It gets a machine name. You pick the REST server, you give it a path. In my case, I'm going to use the path API, and then authentication if you want it. And then in the resources tab that you get for editing this, you can, in the resources tab, you can look at the kinds of things that you can get. The node resource or the system resource, a taxonomy resource. There's one for a lot of native Drupal objects. And make sure that you enable for each kind that you want information to come out, enable the index resource because it lists things and otherwise your front end app won't know what's available to it. So when you put URLs together, they take the form of your site URL and then the root is endpoint/resource.format. So for my local server, headless.dev, and the resource endpoint, services endpoint API, that first URL will give us a list of nodes. The second one will give the contents of node 5. Same thing for XML. By the way, there is an attached files service if you have things like image fields, so that you can do it. Let me. Switch over to Chrome and see if we can do this. So headless.dev API node JSON will return this. Oh, look, it is the .json. Look, that's pretty printed. Node.xml returns that. And this is all the information that Drupal has about these nodes. I didn't pick fields as in views. I just am pointing it at a particular resource, and I'm getting it here. Great, node5.json. One issue that I have had, and that you may have, let's find the image field, here it is that you get stream wrappers, right? So you might need to, that you can hook service alter this stuff. I mean, you get it for free from views, honestly. Files, 5.json, is that the wrong? 5.files.json, thank you. There it is. And ooh, super efficient base64 encoded file that you get out of that. So, I mean, there it is. It's all there for free. The other thing, where do I want to go? Keynote. The other thing that we can use is the REST-WS module. The REST-WS module has a slightly different architectural philosophy, uses the Entity API, and it exposes entities. It's a more completely thought-out hypermedia system, maybe, though not the awesome HAL output that you saw in Steve's talk from Drupal 8 yesterday, but this module is the basis of the Drupal 8 REST server. It's called REST-WS, d.o/project/REST-WS. So this is what the endpoints look like. There's no API endpoint. This is what the resource URLs look like. I mean, it's just node 5. You just add on .json. To it, and here is what the output looks like. Maybe. So if we lose the API, we got files. So it looks. It looks similar, but you get entity values for the HTML, which strikes me as not unwelcome. All the references to other entities give you a URI component so that you can give you a URI property on the object where you can access that. Thing, field image, still gives you this, and you can go get the URL from there. Field integer is this, field list. Remember how I said option 1, option 2, option 3 don't come through? There it is. So you get, just make sure you know that. And then things like an edit URL, so you actually could put an edit link in your in your JSON. Awesome. Moving along. Time flying. So, hey, structured data out of structure. Oh, and by the way, the REST-WS module exposes a different set of permissions so that it will respect the node permissions, and in addition, you can prevent people, you can keep people out. One more option for this is building a custom API that can go get things out of Drupal. I mention it because in situations where performance is very important or where your needs are highly customized, rather than like outputting the value of nodes, you might want to go this route. I know that Krifkin, the dev shop Krifkin, has had great success doing this. So that would be a good vendor for someone who's looking to do something like this, especially since theirs has a lightweight bootstrap. So it only gets the parts of Drupal that it needs. And you can get like, C was bragging about sub 250 millisecond times on it. I'm gonna skip authentication in the interest of time. I actually wanna demo a little bit of work here. So briefly on the front end, You want to use dependency management when you're building your front-end project, whether it's Composer to manage PHP dependencies or Bower for other front-end type of packages, right? Because how do you get jQuery into your project, right? Like, visit the website, click to download the package, open the zip, navigate, find the file that you want, copy it into the code base. No, we're not going to wget it either. We're not going to remember all the dependencies that our dependencies have and stuff like that. So we get Composer or Bower for PHP, other ones respectively. We have a build process that, you know, pulls all these things into our process, into our front end repo. We use Grunt as a task runner. And then I have found that one does not simply scaffold out a website, and that Yeoman is a very good tool that I found for scaffolding out stuff. So that is the end of the, scaffolding out front-end things like an Angular app or a Backbone app or stuff like that. There are highly opinionated stacks that have file structures and that have pre-built grunt files that will concatenate, minify, and do all the stuff that you want. They'll wire up require.js for you, all that stuff. And I find it very useful to get that stuff into the repo. So that is it for the slides. And thank you for listening to them. Let me show you some work.